believe that together, you would take this town by storm. You are Puerto Rico. Willie's from New York. Call this salsa. A sauce like gumbo. Mixed con mambo, rumba, plena, jazz, merengue. You'll cook it up.
I spent so much time in New York, and it was such a wonderful thing when the whole Fania movement was happening. And, I mean, it was next to the 60s that these guys were kind of doing their own thing and bringing the tropics into Manhattan. I have been myself uprooted from Cuba, so I've always been kind of curious about the effects of being uprooted and adapting and the culture clash, and therefore that whole kind of concept of the New Yorican and the island coming to another island in Manhattan. A lot of the guys that were there were keeping a culture alive. That to me was fascinating as a way of retaining who you are, and not only retaining it, but making it explode like it did in those days in Manhattan when these guys filled Central Park or the streets of the Lower East Side or Madison Square Garden and all the other nightclubs that at some point were playing this music. Hector brought the island with him, because that was also one thing about Hector, that he oozed Puerto Rico. And for some of these young guys, some of them hadn't been to the island. Like when Willie Colon met Hector, I think Willie hardly spoke Spanish.
Feels good to be a New Yorican holding up a trombone instead of a tray, a hotel elevator.
I read the script and I said, I gotta be in this movie. I just have to be in it. You know, it doesn't matter what I play in it, I just gotta be a part of this story, because it's been a part of my upbringing. You know, I remember listening to the music when my family had Christmas parties and reading, and I was like, oh my God, it just took me back to being a kid. Willie is shown in a very celebratory way, and through his music and through his relationship with Hector, and, you know, being an innovator when it came to all the different kinds of music that he combined, you know, from early on with jazz influences to Mexican to Peruvian, you know, and him bringing the trombone to the forefront of salsa, which I think was the first time that was ever done. I saw him perform in the Bronx in this little club. He was doing a benefit for the police athletic league. I was more wanting to see him play and kind of just like take it all in and see how he held the trombone and see how he commanded the stage.
Something that I kept insisting on was to try to get as many of the other real people as we can, like Yomo Toro, you know, who was his cuatro player, Eddie Montalvo, Tito Allen, the musicians of Germán Gual. A lot of people began to come to the table. That was also part of what made the project richer, that it gave it some kind of validation, like, yeah, they're coming, they're working. They were part of that, and now they're part of this. So everybody kind of came and took their hats off for Hector.
Me and ustedes.
Even though it's a Latin project about Hector Lavoe and everybody involved in it is Latin, it should be a story that touches everybody, that anybody can watch and understand. And you do that by bringing people into a world, this Puerto Rican thing in the 70s, this revolution that was happening at that time. Oh, I don't know about this world, but then it's a story that they can relate to. You know, obviously there's a lot of stuff in here that is extraordinary, but I think there's a lot of themes in it that people will relate to and understand.
I just wanted you to be proud of me.
Musicians' lives, and you are a musician, you know that even if we go back to jazz, we go back to Piaf, we go back to Judy Garland, we go back to rock and roll, they're always this kind of dramas. They're not like just our culture that we say, oh, well, you know, it's the Latin. No, it's everybody's music gets affected by some kind of tragic consequences.
There's a very famous song that Ruben Blades wrote for Hector. It's called El Cantante.
Yo soy el cantante.
Ruben Blades, a great composer that he is, talks about making people laugh and sing, but no one asks the singer, are you in pain? And that was the story of Hector.
We shot a scene in the recording studio back in New York. It was the last thing I shot where I had to perform El Cantante. And in the middle of the second take, I actually started listening to the words and what it meant to be a singer.
Me paran siempre en la calle. Mucha gente que comenta. Oye, Hector, tú estás hecho. Siempre con hembras y en fiel.
There was a little of every performer I've ever met. There was a little of me. I've been in it so long. But his in particular. And it came towards the end of filming. And not only did I feel that he was there, But it's a little embarrassing to say, but I thought I was ruining the take because I started crying uncontrollably. And I couldn't control it. I couldn't control it. It was a gift. I mean, it really, really was. And something that's really hard to explain, but I feel like I'm different for it.
Mark has been able to do roles, and so have I, that, you know, are not about the fact that we are Latin. But I can say my most fulfilling roles have been the ones that were Latin for some reason. This Lena, this role. I think what it's about is once you get older, because for me, when I was younger in New York, you don't think about it as much, but as you get older and you realize that that's your roots, you feel a pull to that. You want to know everything about it. You revel in and joy in the fact that you're Puerto Rican and that you have that culture. And it defines who you are, you know? It's like when you're little and you're home and you have Christmas or whatever and you're eating Puerto Rican food and they're playing Spanish music and you're like, I hate this! Blame, you know, English music, you know? And then when you grow up and you leave home, all you want to do is listen to Spanish music and all you want to do is eat home cooking and you miss everything about your culture and who you are. You become more connected. You know who you are and you know that that's a big part of who you are, and that, I think, pulls you to the island. And I think as far as Hector's concerned, him leaving when he was older and being born there,
Puerto Rico, papi.
He very much died a little bit every day from the time he left there. For later. Yeah. But for now.
Fuck you! Fuck you!
In the middle of this mayhem, he wanted everyone to feel comfortable when he didn't have to. Because no one had anything bad to say about Hector. It was the Ay Bendito all the way across. All the way across the line was like, man, you know, man, his life and his track. Yeah, but what did he do? He's like, Hector? No. That was, man, you know, the Fania, the music, the people around him. It was like, did you expect him to accept any responsibility for anything he did?
I believe there's various types of artists. I believe there's artists that are respected. There are artists that have hit records at the moment. And then there's artists that are loved. They could do anything. And fans just love them. That was Hector. I didn't really manage him. Ralph Mercado managed him. I was more on the booking and road management, which is...
Well, yeah,
you
but you're on the road with him.
Yeah, but he would be late, or he didn't show up, and I'd be having heart attacks. And he took all my hair off, because Hector Lavoe did that. You know, it was nerve-wracking to get him on stage, but when he did, when he'd sing and control the crowd, it was phenomenal.
This was like a little mafia, you know? It was like a group of men, of guys that were parenting this movement.
They actually brought salsa to the mainstream, which at that point wasn't done yet.
Exactly.
He had a great eye for music and talent. Mm-hmm. And that's how he formed with Jerry over here, the Fania Records.
Jerry Masucci.
I am. He started one of the most important Latin labels.
The black musicians have Motown. Now the Latin musicians are going to have their own label, Fania Records.
That's the one thing about this time of salsa, historically. These people were characters within themselves, because Ralph Mercado was a personality.
The way you could describe him would be more like the Puffy of his day, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
A guy that was an entrepreneur, he was a promoter, you know, he was Hector Lavoe's manager for many years. I look at him as just a consummate businessman.
Ladies and gentlemen, damas y caballeros.